Hey folks, Dr. Mike Isertel here for RP Plus, RPU, just RP in general. Lecture number 6, adjusting calories and macros for fat loss dieting to keep the losses coming. Let's see what's on the menu. Well, we're going to talk about how to know when to adjust calories, which is a really, really big question, probably the central one. We're going to talk about how to adjust calories up and down, okay, in order to keep us on that trend line that we set. Then we're going to talk really quickly about reasons to adjust protein, how to do that, reasons to adjust carbs, how to do that, and reasons to adjust fats. So let's take the first one. How do we know when to adjust calories? Well, I think like, well, I'm losing weight, then I'm good to go. But are you losing enough weight quickly enough in order to meet your goal? Or are you losing so much weight so fast that you'll get way ahead of your goal, get over-dieted, get too fatigued, and burn out? So all of that, I mentioned goal in both of those, you have to have a goal, right? So when you're dieting, when you start dieting right before, you want to pick a planned amount of time that you're dieting, and you want to pick a weight you want to get to. What that's going to result is a certain percent of loss per week, or put another way, for every week that you're dieting down, you're going to have a rough estimate of about how much you should weigh. Like if you start dieting at 200 pounds, 12 weeks later, you're supposed to be at 180. Like at every week, it'll be, you know, 198, 196 the next week, 194, so on and so forth, right? So when you know what weights you're expected to be, you can sort of have plus or minus a little bit, maybe a close percentage band there that tells you, you know, you're going to, maybe you start at 200. That's same thing as starting somewhere between 198 and 202. So that when you're supposed to be weeks later, 190, if you're as low as 188, and really it's with the cutoffs you'll see later is 2% actually. So that's 4 pounds at roughly 200. So if you're supposed to be, let's say 190, you can be as low as 196 and you're still sort of on track. And you can be as high as 194 and still consider yourself on track. Of course, the next week, let's say it's 2 pounds down every week, 184 is not going to cut it anymore. It's 192. And then instead of, 186, or average 190, you're going to have to be, you know, at 184. So it's 184 to 192 is now your band. So the band shifts down as well. But you have this band, and basically the reason we have a band is because if we have an exact line, gee, it gets, you know, do you really want to be on that line? Your scale's not even that accurate. It's just a huge headache. But a band allows us some good freedom. You don't actually have to have the band be an average. You can have the band be the right below average. So like you say, you start at 200, the next week you have to be below 198 and above 194, right? And the next week below 196, above 192. So the band can have you under your goal every time so that you meet just under. You don't want to like say, hey, my goal is 180 and I finished at 183, which is technically within 2%. Like, yeah, you probably want to finish at 180. So my best advice is to have that band appear just under your expected rate of loss. So now that you have that band, you're going to see, okay, when do I start tracking it? Well, big news is in the first week, body water fluctuations account for almost all the weight differences you see on the scale. So how you do in the first week, it's probably not going to be indicative of anything you're doing. So yeah, track your first week, but ignore it with your manipulations. So if you gain a little bit of weight in your first week, don't worry about it. If you lose a lot of weight in your first week, don't worry about it. Don't just put more food back in. The second week is when you start looking at the numbers relative to your goal and where you should be. That's going to start to have more of a picture for you. So a lot of times, the first week you lose a bunch of water weight, and the second week you lose weight at a more steady pace. Now that you're in your second week, it's like, do I compare to the reference values I have? So second week, let's say top was 198, bottom was 194, I'm at 195, check, I'm on track, super good to go. Whereas in the first week, you could have been down already to 196, which is technically all the way at the bottom of your range. You're going to be like, oh geez, maybe I need to eat more food, too soon, too much water. At week two, you're tracking, week three, week four, five, etc. Then that data starts to be good to go. So the tracking and adjustment process is actually super simple. If it's within your band of acceptable losses, like whatever you weigh, it's within that little band, just below your weight you want to be and all the way to a lower value, you do nothing. right? That's the really cool part about fat loss dieting, is once you develop what some people refer to as like a sort of diet momentum, you might be on almost the exact amount of calories. Let's say your goal is to lose roughly 2 pounds a week. Like, that's what it translates to. If you're losing about 2 pounds a week every week, maybe you lose like 2.2 one week, 1.9 the next week, 1.7 the next week, 1.5. That still averages to close enough to two, where that's within your band every single time. Good news, you just don't have to adjust your diet. Some people in the RP clients group, for example, many of our clients before, they're the ones you sort of like love to hate. They're the ones that are like, I started, like, the app changed my my macros once, and then I just met all my goals, and it just said keep on going, because the app does this almost exact thing. It's got a little bit more nuance in it. It's a bit more mathematical and methodical, using a little bit more advanced mathematics, but it essentially does this process. So sometimes people will get on this drift where they're like, basically, like, the deficit is essentially what they need, and the app will, like, start you in week one, and it might not make a change until week eight. And you say, like, you know, some people actually give feedback, like, the app doesn't seem to be changing anything. And we're like, are you on track? And they're like, yes. And we're like, why the hell would it change anything? Like, that's perfect. You do the same stuff and it just gets you awesome, awesome, awesome results. Don't change a thing. Now, if you're below the band, we probably want to adjust the calories up at some point. Like, if you're losing like 5 pounds a week, like, you just guessed totally wrong and you're starving to death, like, that's probably not sustainable and you want to adjust up, right? So we'll talk about how to do that. If you're above the band, you want to adjust calories down, which is going to be the much more common thing on a fat loss phase. So a lot of times you make an adjustment and then your metabolism slows down a tiny bit. Your non-exercise activity thermogenesis drops quite a bit. You start losing weight, which means your metabolism slows down just because you're smaller. And all of a sudden, 3 or 4 weeks after an adjustment, you're not losing much as much weight as you need. And now you are over, you're out of the band for the first time. You're over the trend line. You're way too much, more than you're supposed to be. And at that point, you have to make another adjustment to your diet to lower the calories to continue to be on track, right? And all you do is, for all the weeks of the diet, you just repeat these steps 1 through 3 as needed. And voila, you have an algorithm and a formula by which to make sure you're always on track with your diet. That's it. So, how do we actually go about doing this? How do we adjust down, right? So, super common on a fat loss diet is you might be above your acceptable loss band. So, for example, you should have weighed roughly 196 at a certain week, and you did, like 195.2. The next week, you should have weighed roughly 194, and you were 194.8. It's still within range. The next week, you were supposed to weigh 192, and you weighed like 193.9 or something, and it was apparently too far, right? Or you weighed 194.1 again. And you're not supposed, you know, that's outside of the margin. You're clearly just not losing weight fast enough. You probably have to adjust down. So how do we adjust down? Well, here's the thing. If you're just over your expected value, like, let's say you're supposed to be at, the highest value you gave yourself was 192 for that week. And let's say you're like 192.4 or something. Do you have to cut a bazillion calories? No, because you're real close. So if you're just over the value, and what that means we'll get into in just a bit, but it doesn't super matter how you define it as long as you're consistent, you want to subtract roughly 10% from your calories. So for example, if you're eating 2,000 calories the week before, you go to 1,800 calories after. That's like down 200 calories in that case. Not a huge adjustment, but just enough to keep you banging and keep you on track. If you're... In this example, we use 2% above, which is why I was using those, you know, two pound values or 4 pound values for the 200 pound person. If you're 2% above, which is like, so basically your average value you wanted to hit was 196, but you happen to weigh 200, right? Or your average value you wanted to hit was 190, but you're just 194. And that's 2% above. You think, gee, yeah, 2%, that's a lot. I'm going to have to cut a lot of calories, but that's where you get a little mathematical. This is something that the app does in a more advanced way, but something you can now do yourself if you'd like, is you actually look at the trend line that's occurred in the last several weeks, maybe the entire trend line, but probably just the last 2 weeks or so. And let's say, you know, you wanted to weigh 190, but you weigh 194. Okay, but you don't just weigh 194 this week. On average, you have a trend line that extends out, let's say, 2 weeks. If that trend line is like this, right? So you're supposed to go up, 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 goal. If the trend line is on a slope that at some point intercepts this line that takes you to your goal, basically, like, yeah, you're still over the line, but you were even further over the line a while back, and now you're approaching the line. Or if the slope is really close to the line, like if it intercepts your target line at all, like if you draw it out, like basically say, well, I'm over the line right now, but if I keep losing at this rate that I've been for the last 2 weeks, I'm going to get through to my goal maybe even way early. If that's the case, just only subtract 10% still. You don't want to make this huge subtraction. Like, you're sort of already well on your way. You don't want to just leave that alone because it could bottom out and then you're just still behind. So you still want to make that 10% cut. But that's going to catch you up real soon, and then you can sort of let go and let the automation take over, right? But you don't want to, like, cut a crap load of percent and have it just dip down so you'll come back up later. So if you're well on your way already, you're just not at your goal yet for whatever week, if the slope line points down of the last 2 weeks and you're going to intercept your target at some point, just a 10% cut. Now, if you're quite a bit above, right, and or your slope for the last 2 weeks is neutral or up, you probably want to make a 20% calorie per day reduction. So like you're supposed to be at 190, you're at 194, but the last 2 weeks, your slope's like this. Your target is this. You're just going to keep, like, you're gaining weight. Let's say you're just not losing it at all. Right? Or even you're losing, but like you're supposed to be losing at this rate, but you're losing at this rate. You're just never, you're going to get further and further away from your goal. Put it this way. If your goal is 180 at the end, you make no adjustments, you're going to end the diet at 188. I mean, like that's not success. You know, that's cool. You lost 12 pounds, but the goal is 20. You want to take that seriously. So at that point, if your line slope, so this is your slope of the line of two weigh-ins or two straight weeks of weigh-ins. This is a slope of your line that you want to be on. If your slope is not going to intercept, if it's higher slope, then and you're more than 2% above, you cut 20%. If your slope is neutral or anything above the slope, 20%. If it's like this, really for sure 20%, right? So then basically, if you're a 2,000 calorie diet, that means you cut 400 calories from the next week. I mean, that's a big cut. 20% is no joke. You're going to feel it. The thing is, you need it at that point, because if you're supposed to be losing 2 pounds a week, but over the last 2 weeks you gained 2 pounds, or the last 2 weeks you no change, or you lost 0.2 pounds, and now you're pretty far, you're 2% off of that expected line, yeah, you're eating way more calories than you're supposed to be in order to get where you are, and you have to make that big of an adjustment. So notice it's a two-tiered adjustment. So if you're pretty close that you need a little bit of a nudge to get within range, 10%. If you're far off and you look like you're not headed in the right direction, you need a bigger change still. What about adjusting up, right? If you're below your acceptable loss band, how do you adjust up and do you? Well, if you're just under the band, like within 2%, don't do anything because you'll be in the band soon, or you'll be intersecting the line soon. For example, let's say that you're supposed to weigh 190, but you weigh 196, right? Like 2% off or something, like roughly 2% off. Do you need more food? No. Sorry, 196. Good God. 186, right? So you're supposed to be at 190 right here, and you are at 186. Well, the next week you're supposed to be at 188. Let's say you don't lose any weight. You're still at 186. You're still below. The next week after, you're supposed to be at 186. You'll just intercept that anyway. And because you're not so far below, it's not like you're getting crazy underfed. You're not going to be super tired. You're not going to burn out. So if you're just under, don't do anything because it's not a big deal. Your fat loss is going to basically, your diet fatigue is going to allow, is going to catch you up to the steady march of the lower expected goal weight. Okay, so don't do anything if you're super close to the band. If you're as much as 2% off, right, or even a little bit more, but the trend line that you're on right now gets below or close to the line that you want, then you also do nothing. So for example, let's say you are supposed to be 190, but you are 185, and you're like, geez, you know, that's like more than 2%. That's not so great. Or let's say you're just 186 to keep it simple, right? Exactly 2%. You're 190 or 186, but the slope of your line is neutral so that you're going to intercept this line in like 2 weeks. Do nothing. Here's your, so the slope of the line that you're trying to get to, and let's say like this is all the way over here is the end goal. Let's say your slope is positive actually, okay, but you're so far under that it intercepts just at the line, at the goal, or just below. Do nothing. If the slope is negative, but it's not as negative as this line, and you still get to the target at the same time or just below, maybe 2% below it. For example, if your goal is 180, but if you just keep going at this slope of the last 2 weeks, you're going to get to 177. That's fine. You're not going to die. You're not going to starve to death. It's going to be cool. A little bonus round, right? Totally fine. Now, then you do nothing in those cases. However, if you're 2% off or more, and especially if your loss slope doesn't get remotely close to the final goal, it's way below, then you want to cut the calories, up the calories by, 10 to 20 calories, 10% to 20% calories per day, probably 10% calories per day. Because, you know, you're on a cutting diet, just adding a bit of calories will probably slow things down, no big deal. So what do we mean here? The slope of the line is like this to get you to your goal here. You're way below, and the slope of your line is that, okay? So, like, you're supposed to end your diet at 180, but you plot it out and say, okay, if I keep losing at this rate, I'm going to end at 168. Like, whoa, that's way too fast. And if you do the math, that's way more than 1% body weight per week. That's within our danger zone of losing muscle, accumulating tons of fatigue, sleep loss, so on and so forth. Nothing we want, and a huge setup for a big rebound to gain a bunch of weight after, because you'd be starving to death. So basically, if you're way below your goal and your trend line is so aggressive that it's not ever going to get close to your goal, you'll lose way, way, way too much weight, then you're going to want to increase calories by roughly 10% per day the next week. And then, so, you know, your goal will be like this and you increase calories and it might go like this and then it'll get really close and super, right? Fundamentally, this is a good place to be because it's cool to be able to add some food into your diet and still make all your goals. But if you're way above your weight loss goal, you're not in a great place. You're going to have to suffer a little bit and cut a bit of calories. So we're not saying that it's good to be ahead of the curve, but if you're ahead of the curve, all you got to do is sprinkle in another 10% and you're good to go. Public service announcement, and this isn't actually in the slides, but it's really, really important to mention. It's very tempting when you're way ahead of your curve to just keep chugging along or even make things more aggressive to finish early. The thing is, if you violate that 1% rough rule, 1% of body weight loss per week, if you go above that, you are at a pretty decent risk of losing muscle, of losing strength, of losing performance, of looking a little worse, and much worse than any of those things in most cases. You're at a risk of highly, highly setting yourself up for a nasty rebound on the way back up. So you're basically arrive early. You, instead of 12 weeks, you finish your diet at 8, or at 12 weeks, instead of weighing 180, you weigh 168. And you're like, yay, I did it. And then you're so hungry, you're so fatigued, you're neat, your daily activity is so low that you get one or two Pringles chips. And, you know, once you pop, you can't stop, right? You eat a bunch of Pringles, then you eat a bunch of popcorn. And then a clown is walking with some candy and you physically assault the clown. You take the candy, you eat part of the clown. And then all of a sudden, 2 days later, you weigh, 20 pounds more and you're super bloated and you're miserable. And, why did you do all that? Like if you just stayed within that 1%, got to 180 pounds, you could have easily transitioned into maintenance. It would have been tough for a couple days, a couple weeks, a little bit more hunger, but you're eating more volume foods. You can stick to the diet. And then after a couple of months at 180, you feel like you've always been at 180 and it's super easy to do. So don't bite off more than you can chew. And if you're losing too fast, basically point number three fast on this last slide, make the adjustment. Enjoy more food, because that way you won't run into these nasty problems. All right. So when we're making these adjustments, where do we make them from? Do we cut proteins? Do we cut carbs? Do we cut fats? The answer is it depends, but that's not the only answer. It depends on a couple of things. First of all, the reason we are cutting any macro, the first reason, is going to be just to supply the calorie adjustment. Like, we're not going to be cutting proteins because you're eating too much protein. We might be cutting proteins in order to cut your calories, right? We need that 200 calories or whatever to come from somewhere. When we make a cut, the cut needs to come from somewhere. So that being said, your protein should already be well in line. You should be eating pretty much exactly how much protein you need. So almost never are we going to cut calories from protein. We're going to cut them either from fats or carbohydrates. There is a potential to adjust protein up if you are too hungry. Like, your hunger is radical. We can go as high as 1.5 grams of protein per pound of body weight to mitigate hunger. Two factors there. Going much higher than that probably doesn't control hunger any better. And also it starts to push out so much carbohydrate and so much fat that performance and hormonal health is, or hormonal optimality is starting to really, really take a backseat. Basically, you're eating so much protein that your carbs are too low, your fats are too low, and then you don't get really good results. So yeah, if you or someone you're coaching is at 0.8 grams of protein per pound per body weight and they're really complaining about hunger, you might bump it up to 1 or 1.2 grams per pound. But after that, sort of be easy with the bumping. And at that point, either they just sort of grind out the rest of the diet, or they can do a maintenance phase, or it, you know, decrease the palatability of their food. There's a bunch of other options to choose from. Carb adjustments. Again, number one reason we'd be cutting carbs is not for some magical benefit of carb cutting, losing fat. It's just the calories. But the thing is that carbs are really prized for us because they're very satiating, specifically when they come from fruits and veggies. And they're also going to be supplying our energy levels for walking around and being alive and going to work and school. And also they're going to be a super amazing training energy for us. And they're going to be able to be very anti-catabolic and prevent muscle loss. So we don't want to cut carbs, usually until and unless fats are at minimum levels, below which if we cut fats, we're going to run into some hormonal problems, so on and so forth. So you can cut carbs, but you probably have to cut your fats down to the lowest levels first, roughly 0.3 grams per pound of body weight per day, 0.6 per kilo. And so basically like a 200 pound person, you know, let's say they start out at 120 grams of fat and you slowly cut away at that to make those calorie adjustments for the other slides. And then you get down to 60 grams of fat per day. You probably don't want to cut much more than down to 60. So you leave that alone. And then you're say at 450 grams of carbs, then you start chomping away at the carbs. So first we start chop fats to minimum, then chop carbs until, well, so far as you need, right? And that means carbs can potentially go really low. Usually most people outside of competition dieting, and even then, don't really need to do that, but potentially you have that recourse. What you definitely don't want to do is have way more than enough fats than you need and start cutting carbs. Because if you cut fats all the way down to their minimum requirement, you really just don't pay a price. I mean, they're just mostly extra calories and tasty and stuff. But if you cut carbs right away, then you're going to cost glycogen stores, energy, blood glucose for a nervous system operation, so on and so forth, and it's going to be not the greatest possible thing. So carbs we want to leave alone until we need them when fats are minimum. Sometimes there are other reasons to adjust carbs. Sex drive hormones are too low. You might need more fats. So for example, you know, you're eating tons and tons of carbs, but you cut your fats to minimum and maybe you sort of, you know, we never know when our true minimum is. Let's say you cut to 40 grams because you weigh, you know, something like 160 pounds or something. You cut to 40 grams of fat per day. And it turns out like, you know, your sex drive completely goes like way in disproportion to the calories. You know, maybe like your palatability of your food is totally off. You're just super craving fats, even though you're not hungry. Then maybe you just bump the fats up to 60, take the carbs from 450 and bump them down to like 400. And all of a sudden you're still getting plenty of carbs. You're getting enough fats to where your fat cravings are pretty much gone or just with what you would normally expect in a diet. Your sex drive back, whatever, your hormones are good. You made the right decision. Sometimes that happens, but if you are careful about cutting your fats not super low, it usually won't happen. You know, if you don't cut fats enough and you sort of have that fat low, sometimes you're in a place where you need way more recovery, way more training energy. And if you're super good on fats, like you said, your sex drive, your hormonal level seem to be really good. And then you're not craving fats at all. And you're just really craving carbs. And more specifically, you're like, okay, I need more training energy. My training energy is sinking. You could be like sort of, you know, at 60 grams of fat and you could try to cut to 40. So you give yourself a bump of another what, 50 grams of carbs or so. When you do that, you might have realized that you're better training, more energy from the increased carbs, same calories because you lower the fats, and you never really pay the price because it turns out the fats were in excess of your minima anyway, and you're totally fine. So that's a potential reason. Most of the time, though, it's going to be pretty straightforward. You're going to cut your fats until your minima, and then you're going to start cutting your carbs as needed to get to the rest. Lastly, how do we cut fats? Well, it's to adjust calories. You usually start with cutting fats. Specifically, if you start out with a pretty high fat diet or even a moderate fat diet, or it's like it says here in the slides, from no diet at all, like you just start, you used to eat something and then you start eating sort of clean for the first time or some kind of measured way. And then, you know, it's going to start cutting the algorithm here is going to start cutting calories. And you say, okay, protein we need for muscle, we never cut. Carbs we need for performance, we don't want to cut. Fats, we're well past that limit that they're at. We can just cut them. So you cut fats for that reason. Sometimes people start with fairly low carbs and lots of fats, and then you can cut fats for a while. Sometimes you end up cutting fats based on automatic meal choices. And you just, sometimes this is the process of cleaning up someone's diet, so to speak. So for example, if someone used to eat like full fatty meats and a bunch of cheeses and stuff, when you start choosing leaner sources, like more egg whites and chicken breasts and lean turkey instead of fatty meats, all of a sudden your fat sources are down anyway. Another one is, you know, instead of eating junk food like potato chips or something, you could eat junk food like low fat potato chips, so on and so forth. And even though you're not trying to cut the fats, you're just eating sort of a lower calorie options, and that cuts the fats by default, right? A lot of times people eat regular diets, they clean up their diets, they eat more fruits, veggies, whole grains, lean meats. All of a sudden, they just by accident cut like 50 grams of fat on their diet and they're losing weight like crazy. Hilariously enough, sometimes they say, I didn't change the amount of food I ate. I just started eating better sources and I lost a ton of weight. So calories don't matter. Like, it's the kind of food you eat. Like, well, it turns out if you had counted your calories, you accident slashed like 600 calories from your diet, right? It's like people who stop drinking soda for the first time ever and lose a bunch of weight. And they say, it was the soda that was making me gain all that weight. Like, no, it was the 400 grams of carbs you had per day from those 10 sodas you were drinking. So that's definitely a thing. Fats are very ripe for the cut until and unless you get to below minimum values. Then you want to leave them alone and get to carbs. How often are you going to cut your fats to the lowest, cut your carbs to the lowest, and still need to cut? At that point, you're well due for a maintenance phase in almost every case, unless you're a competitive bodybuilder and you're 2 weeks away from a show, then maybe you'll have to do what it takes. Should you ever be cutting protein? Almost certainly not. Do some advanced diet coaches cut protein when they prepare figure clients for a competition? Sometimes, but that's almost nothing you're ever going to run into. If you are going to run into that, it should be after years of coaching experience. Folks, that's it for this lecture. Next time, we talk about adjusting timing, adjusting food composition, and supplements during a fat loss phase. See you then.